Hello, folks. My name is Mr. Bill. Today is April 5th, 2007, and this is Fictionasia Disclosure. This is my 29th episode. I hope that I'll have many, many more episodes. I'm going to take a break tonight from the Codex Magica, which I promised part four. And the reason for that is because I want to give some information tonight and information on the origins of the holiday that Christians are getting ready to celebrate, but it's also a pagan holiday. And many of the pagan vestiges that are built into what Christians think as Easter has nothing to do whatsoever with Jesus Christ or his resurrection. So I'm going to concentrate tonight on the origins of Easter. I want to thank the folks 2 weeks ago when I put my live phone number up on the air for the first time. I got home from the studio and I had tons of phone calls. I had some really good callers, but I also had some tricksters that were trying to trick old Mr. Bill. I always welcome phone calls, and I made the statement 2 weeks ago that I'm always there. Well, I live alone and I'm not always there because I'm out doing everything that you have to do to take care of a household. I live alone with my two cats, Jay and Donny Boy. So if you call and I'm not there, I might be doing laundry or cooking supper or washing the car or working in the flower bed or taking care of business. No matter what it is, if I'm not there, it means that I'm either not at home or I'm just taking care of household chores. I also wanted to mention that if you're watching this on April 5th, you're watching it live. Every Sunday at 1 p.m., this program replays. So if you miss the live programs, you can always tune in on Sundays at 1 p.m. and catch a replay. So I wanted to get into the origins of Easter tonight, because right now the mega corporations are laughing all the way to the bank. They are making billions of dollars on candied eggs, little chocolate rabbits, cards, candies, flowers, clothing, all these aspects of Easter where people go out and buy in a frenzy, just like on Christmas. A lot of these corporations know exactly what they're doing, and they know that a lot of the American people, especially the Christians, have been totally duped as far as the origins of Easter and why they have mixed in all of the pagan idolatry and symbology into the Christian teaching of the resurrection of Christ. Well, first of all, those Christians who bother to study and bother to research know the facts that I'm going to be giving tonight. But sadly, I'll have to say there's many, many people out there that don't take the time. They say they don't have the time. And so that's what I'm here for. I consider myself a watchman, a person who has the time to research and to give the people the disclosure about a lot of the fiction that they believe in. And of course, that's why we call the program Fictionasia Disclosure. And below the title there is my home phone number. And like I said, you can call me anytime. I'm kind of a night owl. I do most of my writing and researching at night. But you can call any time of the day, and if I'm there, we'll sit and we'll talk for hours if you want to. So I want to begin now on the origins of Easter. And most of what I'm going to be giving you is my writing mixed in with research that I have obtained from other people. But this is all written in my own handwriting. It's part of the ongoing book that I'm writing. One day I'll get it done. So to begin with, the message of Christ's birth and the manner in which he was born has only one meaning, and it is the fact that the Creator, Yahweh, came into the dimensions of our world, our cosmos, free of sin, to pay our deserved penalty of death. that we might return unto his presence, which is what he originally had planned for us. We might return there clean and free of sins, and we might not be separated from him, which is basically what we are now through all of the garbage that we do in our lives. To diminish that incredible, wonderful, selfless act in any manner, shape, or form is nothing less than to literally take his very name in vain. Taking the name of the Creator in vain doesn't mean saying GD this or Jesus Christ that when you get mad. That's not taking the name in vain. It's taking his name in vain and then twisting everything that he said. And you say that you're doing it in his name. Christmas is paganism, as Easter is also. And these are vile possessions of the beast and very useful tools of Satan, otherwise known as the dragon, the serpent, the Nakash, the Draco, the deceiver, the enchanter, the fascinator. Well, the beast lives on through the celebration of Christmas and also the celebration of Easter. Well, what is the second most popular day of holy worship to the Christians today? Well, the answer is Easter. The question is, why do Christians celebrate Easter? And like Christmas, was Easter recommended by the Creator as a celebration to honor Yeshua Mashiach, Jesus Christ? And what exactly is Easter? And where did it originate and why? Well, Easter is the ancient pagan festival that celebrated the resurrection of the fertility god or goddesses after the ancient carnival that was called the Mardi Gras, M-A-R-D-I-G-R-A-S, Mardi Gras. The name Ishtar, spelled I-S-H-T-A-R, pronounced Easter, literally was the name of the pagan virgin goddess of spring. In the ancient world, it was said that life began at this time of the year, the spring. This was the time of the year when trees began to bud and flowers began to bloom after a long, severe winter. The hope of the ancient people, the ancient pagans, was that they would survive a cold, hard winter and that the gods would bless them as they resurrected nature's crops every spring. Well, 1,000 years before the birth of Jesus, Yeshua, the gods of nature were celebrated as resurrecting at this time of the year. The goddess Easter, spelled E-A-S-T-E-R, had many names in the different cultural societies. And those names were Ostara, spelled O-S-T-A-R-A, Ishtar of the Babylonians, spelled I-S-H-T-A-R, Estera, who was the goddess of the East of the Saxon people. There was Ostern, spelled O-S-T-E-R-N, of Germany. There was Astarte of the Syrians, which was a Greek form of Asherah. Well, in the Bible, it was the Hebrews who fell away from worship to Yahweh after they crossed into the Canaanite countries. They took on the worship of Asherah, and they did this in the grove. It was called the Grove of Baal, the Grove of Molech, and was also called the Ashtoreth. They worshiped the pole, they worshiped the tree, and they did it in the form of the female deities of the Mediterranean. And this also included Venus, Aphrodite, Diana, Ceres, Cybele, Isis of Egypt, and Mileta. And the female deities were called, they were given the title, the Queen of Heaven. Is there a religion today, a denomination, an offshoot of Christianity that worships today the Queen of Heaven? Have you ever heard of Catholicism, the Catholicos? Well, the female deities were all forms of the tree goddess that was mentioned in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 10, in the Bible, Isaiah, chapter 44, and Jeremiah, chapter 44. And this all goes back to Babylon, the mother of harlots, as mentioned in the book of Revelations. And you can find that in Revelations, chapter 17, verse 5. This system began at the civilization of Babel, which was mentioned in the book of Genesis, chapter 11. Babel was the city, founding city, along with the city of Lagash, Nineveh, Yorek, that the king Nimrod founded, which later grew and became the nation empire of Babylon. It was the deification of Nimrod's wife slash mother, whose name was Semiramis. And she was considered, like I said, the wife slash also mother of Nimrod. And the male deities in the legend were the mythological reincarnation of Nimrod. Supposedly, what Semiramis claimed, that after Nimrod's death, he was reincarnated through her womb. In other words, he was reincarnated as a god. Well, the male deities in this mythological reincarnation legend of Nimrod, because this is what the people literally believed then, they were called the virgin-born sons, and they were called by different names. Some of the names were Tammuz, Mithra, Hercules, Baal or Baal, Attis, A-T-T-I-S, Thor of the Scandinavian belief, Horus, who was the son of Isis and Osiris in Egypt, Ictinike, he was the spirit god of the Native American Indians, and of course Isi, which gets into the Oriental languages, the Oriental religious beliefs in this reincarnation of the sun god in the form of a virgin-born son. The birthday of the male deities was December 25th. These male gods were deified in the stars, and they were deified as variations of the sun. The female deities were deified in the stars, and they were also deified in the formation, the symbology of the moon. The deities were said to die in the winter as the crops die in the winter and resurrect every spring. Well, the last festival of the ancient pagans' year was called Fat Tuesday or Fat Tuesday. And it was also called Shrove Tuesday or Tuesday. We get the word today, Tuesday, from Tuesday, Tuesday. The French word is, like I mentioned before, Mardi Gras, M-A-R-D-I-G-R-A-S. And the Mardi Gras was a carnival held in tribute to the visitation of the sun god in the winter, who was said to die on the last day of the festival. And this was the carnival. I mentioned in my program 2 weeks ago, we had a caller who I believe his name was Steve. And he called and he asked me if I knew about the Khans of Baal. They were the flesh-eating priest of the religion that worshipped Baal. From that, we get the word carnival, which means a festival of eating flesh, a festival of gluttony. Well, this god would die at Mardi Gras, and the mourning, in other words, the weeping for the god, would begin on what the Catholic Church today calls Ash Wednesday. And it was also, well, they get the Ash Wednesday from the Scandinavian term, which was Ash Woden's Day. Well, we literally get the word Wednesday, Wednesday, today, from the Ash Woden's Day. Woden was the son of Odin. Well, Woden actually was the father gods of the Scandinavians. The same belief as the Babylons, the Orientals, just a different name. The name Odin was later changed to the word Woden. Well, from that word Woden, we get our modern day word, our modern day word, W-O-O-D-E-N, Woden. The mourning for this god would last for 40 days. Well, the Roman Catholic Church adopted this period of mourning, and they had the audacity to rename it Lent, L-E-N-T. And I want to make some comparisons here to the number 40, to notice the parallels to the various accounts in the Bible to the number 40. Number one, Moses was on Mount Sinai for 40 days. The people of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 days. The reign of Noah's days lasted 40 days. And Jesus, Yeshua, was in the wilderness for 40 days. Well, during this 40-day period, the worshipers would fast for 40 days. And then on what they called the Day of Annunciation, on March 25th, which was the beginning of the calendar at that time, the God would rise from the dead as the God of vegetation, excuse me. And this was the same time of the year as the Jewish Passover. Now, in the year 1572, Pope Gregory the 13th took measures to get the Christian and pagan festivals amalgamated. In other words, he wanted to blend them together. And he did this by a complicated but very, very skillful adjustment of the calendar. He wanted the festival of Easter, this ancient pagan festival, to line up with the Jewish Pasch, the P-A-S-C-H, which was the Passover of the Hebrews. He was seeking to blend together the pagan traditions with Judaism and with Christianity. In other words, like I mentioned quite a few times, the pot of stew, where you want to have one, say you want to cook a beef stew, you put in beef, and then you start adding all these other ingredients, and you start blending them together and blending them together and blending them together. Well, after that stew is done, you've added so many foreign ingredients into it that you can't even hardly taste the beef anymore. Well, this is what he was trying to do. He was trying to blend together paganism, Christianity, and Judaism, and put them all into one major belief. And that's why he very skillfully readjusted the calendar. Because after all, he was a Catholic pope, and the word Catholic was derived from the Greek word katholikos. That's spelled K-A-T-H-O-L-I-K-O-S. And what katholikos literally means is universal. Katholikos is an adaptation of the Greek kathalu, which means in general. The formal principle of the Catholic Church was expressed by a man named Vincent of Lorenz. And this was around 434 AD. And this is what it said concerning the Catholicos, the Cathalu, the Catholics. That which has been believed everywhere, always, and all that is what is true and properly, this is Catholic. Well, the Bible says there's only one belief that's acceptable to Yahweh. And it was no great difficult task in blending together paganism and Christianity, as idolatry and pagan doctrines had already entered into the various early Christian churches by means of the Catholic Church. The change of the calendar in regard to Easter brought into the church, literally, the grossest corruption and the rankest superstition in connection also with the abstinence doctrine, related to the pagan mourning period that the Catholics renamed Lent. In the carnival, the meaning was farewell to the flesh. And this is exactly what the pagans celebrated in the festival before the death of the god in late winter. Mardi Gras, the Shrove Fat Tuesday, was the time in which the people would eat all of the fat and all of the goodies they could consume before the period of mourning began for the dead god. And the mourning and abstinence began on Ash Wednesday, or Ash Wednesday. The ash was derived from the Ashtoreth, who was the tree goddess of vegetation. The Roman Catholics had the audacity to change all of this paganism and try to candy coat it and call it Christianity. To the pagans, the resurrection of the tree goddess, the goddess of vegetation, meant a horn of plenty, commonly known as the cornucopia. And this was symbolized by the goddess Fortuna, or fortune. And she would be shown pouring out forth fruits and corn from a ram's horn. Sure, you've probably seen pictures of the goddess with the ram's horn full of the plenty of vegetables and fruits, and it's pouring forth from the opening of the horn. When the first crops began to sprout and trees began to bud, with the bees pollinating the flowers, the people wanted to show tribute to the god who had brought them through the winter, the sun god. They would worship him or her, the god or the goddess, by going to their pagan temples before dawn. And they would wait to watch the sunrise, which in their ritual represented the birth of the reincarnated god. And this was called the sunrise service. Well, to you Christians or anyone who's ever studied the Bible, the first record in the Bible of a sunrise service can be found in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 8, verse 12 through 16. And it says, quote, now this is Ezekiel, and God is taking him around, showing him various atrocities that the Hebrew people are doing. Then he said to me, Yahweh said to Ezekiel, son of man, have you seen what the elders of the house of Israel do in the dark, every man in the room of his idols? For they say, the Lord does not see us. The Lord has forsaken the land. And he, Yahweh, said to me again, turn again, and you will see greater abominations that they do. So he brought me to the door of the north gate of the Lord's temple. And to my dismay, women were sitting there weeping for Tammuz. Remember I explained, Tammuz was another name. Well, it was the original name of the virgin-born sun god, which was Nimrod. Nimrod reincarnated through the womb of Semiramis. And these women were sitting there, and they were weeping for Tammuz during this 40-day period, which the Catholic Church renamed Lent and attached it to Jesus Christ. Then he, Yahweh, said to me, have you seen this, O son of man? Turn again, and you will see greater abominations than these. So he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, the temple. And there at the door of the temple, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, and their faces towards the east, and they worshiped the sun towards the east. Well, folks, this is a sunrise service that the people of Israel were partaking in for Tammuz, who was the sun god of Babylon. The women were wailing and weeping in the mourning process of the 40-day period, Lent. After this period, the sun god goddess would resurrect, hence the worship of this god of the east, Easter, as the sun was rising. Well, do we still today see sunrise services where people go to their churches and they worship as the sun is rising? Has nothing whatsoever to do with the birth of Jesus Christ. It's a pagan tradition that slipped into the early Christian church, and we have been duped and following that same tradition for years and years and years. Excuse me. Another aspect of the story of Tammuz was the account that he was not as skilled a hunter as his father, Nimrod. And on Tammuz's 40th birthday, while hunting, he was killed by a wild pig. The 40 days of mourning are in tribute to one day for each of the 40 years of his life. The main food prepared and eaten at the Shrove Fat Tuesday Mardi Gras celebration was roasted pig or ham. Eating the pig during the Easter meal feast was symbolic of killing the animal that killed their sun god. In other words, it was an act of revenge. And it was represented and it was called conquering the destroyer of God, literally. Well, folks, do we still have that tradition today where we cook the Easter ham? Why? Where did it come from? Do you ever question it? Well, I just gave you the origins of it. When spring brought back new buds and leaves as nature began to bloom, the pagans felt that they must further honor their god of the sun in any ritualistic manner possible. Since the trees and flowers had their new clothes or new leaves, new fruit, new buds, the people would all come to the sunrise service in new Easter clothes. And this is where the new Easter outfit tradition comes from. The women would wear bonnets of bright colors adorned with multiple flowers, which was in tribute to the goddess of the spring. Some of the women would bring rabbits or bunnies to the sunrise service, and they would carry them in wicker baskets as a tribute to the goddess. Well, the rabbit, being the fastest reproductive animal, was a symbol of the fertility of the goddess. The legend of the Babylonian goddess Semiramis, who was called the Queen of Heaven, it said that Semiramis, being resurrected in the spring as Mother Nature, would come down from heaven in the form of an egg. And this egg represented new birth. And the egg would contain a blessing. After the sunrise service, the women would set the rabbits free to multiply. And they would go out into the surrounding countryside in search of the egg that contained the blessing from the spring goddess. Well, like I mentioned earlier, today corporations make millions of dollars during Easter selling clothing, hams, Easter baskets, candies, and candied eggs. And what person hasn't been on an Easter egg hunt as a child? Why? Why do we do the things we do? Well, once again, it's because of a blind traditional ritual that has survived for thousands of years. We've been spoon-fed it, and we continue it. For the Christians who truly believe in not polluting the words of Yahweh, all of this is literal filth in his nostrils. It's like a stench. People say, oh, what's the harm? The harm is you don't blend together anything that's pure with anything that's pagan, with anything that's filthy. You don't mix garbage in with your utensils in the house. You take the garbage out, you get rid of it. Well, going on, how did God feel about his children partaking in customs and traditions that honor the sun, the fire worship, and the moon, the tree worship? Well, here are God's own words in answer to that question, Yahweh's own words. In the book of Leviticus, chapter 18, verses 30, it begins, quote, "Therefore shall ye keep mine ordinance, that commit not any one of these abominable customs which were committed before you, and that ye defile not yourselves therein." In other words, you don't pollute yourselves by becoming part of this. I am Yahweh, your Father. Well, in the fertility festivals and celebrations to their gods and goddesses, the pagans revisited the idea of resurrection over and over and over throughout the continuing cycle of every year. And it was a vain memorial to the lifeless gods who had never existed to begin with. And like I said, this all started from the vain imagination of the original Babel, where the people led by Nimrod and Semiramis said, "Let us make us a name for ourselves." And it's paraphrased, "Let's become our own authority apart from God," is basically what that means. When modern man partakes in these vain traditional celebrations, ceremonies, services, rituals, and copycat customs, he is helping to feed and keep alive the very life of what the Bible calls the beast. And by doing these things, you are feeding it and you are fueling it. The Bible teaches that Jesus, Yeshua, died once for all. And he resurrected once from the grave of the tomb. When the Bible speaks of resurrection in the English, it is not talking about the resurrection of Jesus from the tomb. And this is where a lot of people get confused. The common word for a resurrection in the original Greek, long before the English was even thought of, was the word anastasis. It's spelled A-N-A-S-T-A-S-I-S. And what anastasis means is to come to life after death. Well, the thing about this original word in the Greek, they have male gender words, they have neutral words, and they have feminine words. The Greek word is always in this feminine gender referring to anastasis, the resurrection, which means that it denotes and explains or implies a feminine sense or characteristic or a personality trait. Now here's the crux. Since Yeshua is not and has never been feminine in any sense, anastasis, resurrection, cannot be speaking of him. Anastasis, resurrection, is talking about the wife, the bride of Christ, which those of you who understand the New Testament is considered the church. He is the groom, the church is the bride. And the church literally is in a female gender sense. That's why this word anastasis is used, because it's referring to the wife of Christ. The following are verses of scripture concerning the resurrection, the feminine agenda, the feminine gender. The book of John, chapter 11, verse 25 says, "And Yeshua said unto her," the woman who he was speaking to, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." Now, keep listening. Go to the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 22. It says, "Beginning from the baptism of John unto the same day that he was taken up from us," the day that Yeshua ascended, one be ordained to be a witness with us of his resurrection. One must witness with us of the resurrection of Christ in us believers daily. In other words, you have to die daily to yourself, resurrect daily to yourself. And you can't do that unless it's through the original resurrection. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 16 through 18 says, "But shun profane and vain babblings," which means empty sound, fruitless discussion, "for they will increase unto more ungodliness, and their word will eat as doth a canker sore. Of whom two men in the book of Acts, named Hymenaeus and Philetus, who were two young preachers, they were going around preaching after Paul had left these certain churches. And they were trying to speak to people about the truth. They were confusing people on the resurrection. And they were basically teaching that the resurrection with the female gender of Christ in his church was one time in the past. Well, the Greek word for past is the word genomai. And it means to cause to be or become or come into being, literally. Well, past is an infinite verbal noun. It has a verbal action character to it, the past. This means when the present condition is due to a past action or happening. In other words, the present action of being resurrected daily all goes back to the original resurrection, and through that resurrection, we resurrect daily. Nowhere did Yeshua ever write down to be recorded that we are to celebrate his resurrection yearly. He also never told us to worship and celebrate his birth. Why do we do these things? Well, I got through that a little bit quick tonight. That's only a tip of the iceberg. So I guess I'll open up the phone lines and see how people feel about this. If someone has something that they want to add to it, feel free to give me a call. I'd like to spend, probably 6 episodes on Easter and Christmas, but I can't do that because I got a lot of other material that I want to get back to Codex Magica, exposing and explaining to the people about the occult, about Masonry, and about Illuminati. So we got a call. We'll take this call. How you doing? You got Mr. Bill.
How you doing, Mr. Bill?
This must be Phil.
It's Phil.
Haven't talked to you in a long time.
Yeah, did you know that Bush's great-grandfather was Illuminati and he also belonged to Skulls and Bones?
Yeah, right now, Phil, I'm reading a book called The Bloodlines of the Illuminati. It's a 664-page book that I had to send for. And you're talking about Prescott Bush.
No, his great-grandfather.
That's who I mean. Prescott
yeah,
Bush.
Yeah, he's the one that backed up Hitler.
Right. His name was Prescott Bush.
Right.
He was the founder of the Bush Empire. Yes. He funded much of the money that gave the Nazis the rise.
That's right.
During World War II.
And a lot of people.
Before World War II.
And did you ever see the symbols that Bush gives when he waves to people?
Well, you know, I had a friend of mine named Jeff call me the other night, and he saw President Bush doing that dinner with the president from Uruguay.
Mm-hmm.
And when they played the national anthem for Uruguay, Bush did the old lion's paw.
Not only that, he does the horn.
With the thumb tucked in. And Jeff recognized that because he had watched my program. So there's a lot of people waking up to that. If your eyes are in tune, you can see it.
He also does the horns.
Oh, yeah.
He says that when he talks to people.
Yeah, he claims that it's the Hook'em horns for Texas University.
And so does his wife.
Yeah.
His wife does the same thing with.
Because they don't just do this; they do this also.
Yeah.
Hopefully. You're not saying Hook'em longhorns when you do it backwards. So.
I just want to share this with you.
That's a good point.
I enjoy your show.
Yeah, this book, The Bloodlines of the Illuminati, unbelievable. Right now, I'm on the chapter of the Kennedys.
Right.
And it's just blowing my mind. tracing these people back to the original 13 Illuminati families.
Every president that did not belong to the Masons was assassinated.
Yeah.
Kennedy did not belong, he was assassinated.
Lincoln that's the reason why John F. Kennedy was taken out, because he was breaking the mold of what his own family was doing.
That's right. Yeah, I'll let you go.
Okay, you take care, bud.
All right, take care, bye.
Adios. Well, we don't have any more callers tonight. I guess the people are outside enjoying the weather. That was old Phil. Haven't talked to him in a long time. He's got a lot of knowledge. He's done a lot of research. And he's given me some books on the Illuminati, which I always appreciate that, Phil. We got another call here. Hello, you got Mr. Bill. How you doing?
Hi, Mr. Bill. This is Alan.
Alan, how you doing, buddy?
Good. I was just wondering, what is the reason for the apostrophe in the name Baal, B-A-apostrophe-A-L?
Well,
what are they leaving out of the name?
Well, they're not leaving anything out. It's the pronunciation.
Oh.
I always grew up thinking it was Baal. It's pronounced Baal.
Baal.
Right. And what Baal means is it's a distortion of the original god El. And Baal,
like Elohim.
Means it's also spelled Bel.
Yeah.
You remember when the Pharisees called Jesus Beelzebub?
Yeah.
And they were calling him the Prince of Darkness.
Right.
Baal means the son of Al, the son of El.
Yeah.
And El was the chief sun god of the Canaanites.
Yeah, and I heard that he said that they committed a unpardonable sin. Is it possible to commit that sin nowadays?
The only unpardonable sin is to deny the workings of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
It's not to say that I don't believe, or it's not to use God's name in vain. It is to deny the very spirit that literally indwelt Yeshua Mashiach.
That is
the unpardonable sin, period.
Yeah, so it has nothing to do with the practices of today.
No, you've heard a lot of people say that suicide is the unpardonable sin. No.
Yeah.
God doesn't favor that.
Right.
He doesn't give permission to anyone. Yeah, unless you have the power to create life, you do not have the power to take life.
Right, but where are the four cases? I know there's Saul, and I know there's King Saul, and I know that there's Judas. There were supposed to be four mentions in the Bible, and I don't really know what the other two people were.
Well, this teaching that Judas committed the unpardonable sin, that's false.
Right.
You go back to the original text, Judas repented of what he had done.
Yeah.
He took the money back and threw it at the Sanhedrin and said, I want nothing to do with this.
Yeah.
Judas did not want Christ to be crucified.
Right.
Judas wanted Christ to come forward and be a warrior king.
Yeah.
That's why he thought, if I turn him in, this will further him rising to power.
Yeah.
Judas repented. Judas, when it said that Judas was hung.
Yeah.
Well, I think in two of the Gospels, one said he was hung, the other said, and his gut, and he fell. And
yeah, Acts 1:18 and Matthew 27:5.
He was murdered by the Sanhedrin because they did not want the people to know that he had come back and repented.
Yeah.
That's a myth. That's Fictionasia, and we're going to disclose it right now.
Okay.
Listen, I got to get to some other calls, okay?
Okay, God bless.
Good questions, buddy. Hello, you got Mr. Bill. How you doing?
It's Bill again. Did you know Jesus died on a Wednesday?
Yes.
That's when the Passover lamb was slaughtered.
That's right.
Not Good Friday.
That's right. That's another thing, the mythology of Good Friday. And people don't study the Passover. I wish I had enough time tonight to go through and explain when it began, why they said that they must get him off the cross before the, well, they were saying they must
Sabbaths.
Get him up before the high Sabbath.
Yeah, the two Sabbaths.
Right.
You know, and it takes 3 days to be in the tomb.
Right.
If you go by the Jewish calendar, it's from sundown to sundown.
It's from 6 in the evening.
Yeah, to 6 the next morning.
Till 6 the next morning.
I'll let you go, Bill. Thank you.
Okay, good points, Phil. Hello, you got Mr. Bill. How you doing?
Hey, how you doing?
Kerry, how you doing?
No, I'm always watching.
Well, you know, I said I wasn't going to have open phones, but I got through that material, you know, pretty quick. And I was hoping I was going slow, so. How you doing?
I've got a something to talk to you about, but I think I'll do it later on tonight when you get home, because you only got like about 4 minutes. But it's something my wife commented on about what you were talking about, and I'll share that with you later on.
Okay.
But interesting calls tonight.
Yeah.
And I thought it was a great show, and I didn't know what Phil just said, that Jesus died on Wednesday. I didn't hear that.
Yeah, there's a lot
of before.
A lot of convolution and fantasy going on in the churches. They're
then
not.
Why'd they change it? And they
Catholic Church.
Is that what
Church.
They call Good Friday?
Yeah, Good Friday. Yeah.
Why would they call it Good Friday when Jesus died? I don't get that.
Well, they take the whole term of his resurrection, which was a good thing.
Mm.
It was a good thing in the sense that he paid the price, the penalty, for mankind's sin. But when they work this thing out that he rose on Sunday morning, that's false. He rose on the Sabbath, and the Sabbath was not Sunday morning.
What day was that?
It was Saturday.
Oh, yeah, that's
we call
right.
Saturday today.
Yeah, okay.
The Jews consider any part of a day, even if you say, I'm going to go to Carrie's house for 3 days. I'm there Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Maybe I'm not there all of Wednesday, but I'm still there part of Wednesday. They still consider that 3 whole days.
You got about a minute. I'll let you go.
Yeah, I do. I'm getting down. So.
All right, I'll talk to you later.
And it's worked out real good because I don't have any more things lighting up. I got a couple there, but it's getting down to the nitty, folks. I can't take any more calls. I wanted to show you in the background the old swastika, and we're going to get into more teaching about the swastika in the 8 days of occultic practices. And also, I wanted to get back and see if I can disappear here for a second. Well, I wanted to show you in the background is the Book of Yahweh. And what that is one of the best translations I've found of the Holy Scriptures. There it is. And what it does is it retranslates many of those, hundreds of those words that the King James Bible translated wrong. The Book of Yahweh is about that thick. And it contains the whole entire Bible. So, we're getting down to the nitty, to the last, 30 seconds. You folks can call me tonight. I'll be home, probably about an hour after this. I always go by and treat myself to some Mexican food on the way home. That's kind of my little traditional thing I do every other Thursday. Tune in on Sundays at 1 p.m. for the replay of this program. And remember one very important thing. The truth is true, even if everyone denies it. And a lie is and forever will be a lie. Even if the multitude, even if the occult, even if the Masons affirm it. We'll see.